644 to look exactly like the Bob Kappa photographs.
The war correspondent has his stake, his life, in his own hands. And he can put it on this horse or that horse, or he can put it back in his pocket at the very last gamble. I'm a gambler. I decided to go in with Company E in the first wave.
For Robert Kappa, taking pictures was his way of fighting the war against fascism. Instead of carrying a gun, he carried a camera.
His works, I think, taught us a lot because, he dealt with a very cruel circumstance.
He wasn't just an observer. He was really as humane as maybe they don't come like anymore. He really liked people. And I think this is also why people liked him.
Man skulle kunna säga att Robert Kappa föddes i Paris vid 22 års ålder. Några år tidigare, 1933, hade han flytt till Paris från nazisternas Tyskland. Innan han blev Robert Kappa hette han Endre Friedman. Det här fotografiet publicerades i en av Berlins tidningar och det togs i Budapest under en demonstration mot den ungerska diktatorn Miklós Horthy. En av demonstranterna var den då 17-årige Endre Friedman. Han skadades av en polissabel och greps.
In the big square police headquarters, Horthy's chief of police whistled Beethoven's Fifth while beating up long-haired men. I was a young man of 17 with very long hair. The next morning, the police commissioner called my mother and told her that if I left Hungary in 24 hours, certain questions would not be asked.
Endre flydde till Berlin nästa dag.
You went to Berlin in order to learn that which is new. Berlin was the great attraction. Socially, economically, politically, it was dynamic. Things were happening.
Nazisterna hade ännu inte kommit till makten. Berlin var ett viktigt kulturcentrum vid den här tiden. Endre Friedman bestämde sig för att satsa på journalistik. Han ville bli journalist för att kunna bekämpa fascismen med pennan. Han bodde på ett schabbigt pensionat och hankade sig fram på ett litet underhåll. Pensionatets värdinna vräkte honom när hans pengar tog slut.
I had always loved the feel of rain on my face. But now the rain without touching my face went right to my shoes. I had never thought that poverty had anything to do with shoes. Now when I look at poor people, I glance at their feet.
For me, he was Bundy. We called him Bundy, never Kappa, because it was much later came this name.
Eva Bersnyu var en barndomsvän från Budapest. Hon hade precis öppnat en egen fotoateljé i Berlin.
He came and visited me. And he said to me, is photography a nice profession? Just like this. And I said, Bundy, you can't speak about photography on this manner.
Fotokonsten stod högt i kurs i Berlin. Några av de bästa pressfotograferna företräddes av agenturen Defot som drevs av en ungrare.
I brought him to Defot and I said, I have feel a very nice boy, very intelligent and smart. Can't you give him some job? He said, okay, let him come. I brought Kappat to photography and I'm very proud of it.
I ett år sprang Endre ärenden och arbetade i mörkrummet, men så dök ett fantastiskt tillfälle upp. Leon Trotsky skulle tala i Köpenhamn och alla Defots fotografer var upptagna.
Kappa said, let me go. I make a photograph of him. Let me try.
And the photographs were published to great success, not only in Germany, but elsewhere.
Vid 18 års ålder stod Endre Friedman inför en lysande karriär som fotograf, men han var dömd att misslyckas i Tyskland. Efter bara några månader kom Hitler till makten 1933 och Endre var klok nog att lämna landet.
It was not possible to stay. For him, he was Jewish, he was leftist, no. And the whole default where he worked was finished because it was too leftist.
Kappa was a displaced person all of his life.
He was looking at life through that part, that eye. What he was, he never forgot who he was, where he came from. I think he had, as you say, a chip on his shoulder.
Endre Friedman växte upp i Budapest i Ungern, en stad där pengar, klass och geografi skilde människorna åt. Som barn strövade han runt på Budapest fashionabla gator där den rika överklassen fördrev tiden på flotta kaféer. Senare tog han sig över till andra sidan av Donaufloden, till den livliga stadsdelen Pest där hans föräldrar hade ett skrädderi. Deras enkla lägenhet var fylld av textilarbetare som sydde eleganta kläder åt det rika folket i Budapest.
The business person of our family was my mother, who really was a very hardworking lady, and my father was a very light-hearted fellow. He didn't really believe that work was a very essential part of a Hungarian man's life, and came around 6 p.m. he would want to slip out of the house and go and play cards.
On the Pest side stood the Café Modern, where the tailors of Budapest held their daily meetings, which began with complaints about business and ended with Pinnacle.
Fadern spelade med familjeföretagets handkassa och han förlorade ofta.
I disapproved of his way of life and I admired my mother's sturdy, strong character. So I became a sturdy, strong character young fellow and my brother became a gambler.
Ett av Robert Kappas första fotouppdrag var att fotografera strandlivet på den franska rivieran. Han spelade bort hela sitt förskott på en vecka. Han hävdade att han måste få pröva på att leva flott för att kunna skildra det. Han beklagade verkligen när uppdragsgivarens Leica-kamera stals när han tog sig ett dopp. Väl tillbaka i Paris fick han inga nya uppdrag, men han fortsatte att fotografera.
He used to come and have his photographs developed in my father's little dark room. And when Bob didn't have time to stay, he just dumped his film in front of the door because he was always running around like mad.
Kappa had absolutely no success with getting jobs from French editors. Perhaps it was very difficult to become disciplined. In fact, discipline only arrived with Gerda.
Gerda Pohorilles var också judisk flykting från Nazityskland som lyckats ta sig till Paris. Och precis som Kappa hade hon fängslats sedan hon protesterat mot fascismen.
Gerda was able to speak French and other languages and she was always beautifully made up. And she was very vivacious.
Deras förhållande skulle komma att bli stormigt och komplicerat, men sommaren 1935 var de bara nyförälskade.
Never before in my life have I been so happy. Now only the pick and the spade could separate Gerda and me.
De hittade en liten lägenhet nära Eiffeltornet.
I knew that it was the greatest thing in his life at the time. He was really, really, it was passion.
Gerda introduces me to every editor and writes articles besides. On the other hand, she not only doesn't darn my socks, she doesn't do anything about the holes in her stockings. She runs around so much that she wears one out every day.
She would go around and sell the pictures to editors. She was very persuasive, but not quite persuasive enough. It was time for a new strategy. And they decided they would invent an American photographer named Robert Capa. Very successful, so famous that nobody could ever really get close to him. He was always away on assignment or at some glamorous resort on vacation. The name Capa seems to be a play on the name of Frank Capra, who had just won an Academy Award.
And then Gerda decided that she, fancying Greta Garbo, would call herself Gerda Taro, and that they would work together as partners.
Eventually, the ruse was discovered that André Friedman was making the photographs that Gerda was selling as Robert Capa's. And what they decided at that point was since the photographs were so good and they were getting published, that André Friedman might just as well become Robert Capa.
People say he created his own character, but he fit it. He created a character that took advantage of all his innate qualities. I mean, if you had written a character like Bob Capa and you knew him, you'd say the perfect person to play this role is Bob Capa.
Dear good mother, I'm working under a new name. My name is now Robert Capa. It's like being born again. But this time without hurting anybody.
No puede hablarse de la guerra de España sin hablar de Capa y de sus fotos, pero muy particularmente de esta foto. Es que retrata el momento en que un soldado recibe la muerte. Y la recibe, como decía nuestro poeta, en un poema que hay de Miguel sobre eso, la recibe de pie, cayendo, pero de pie. Pierde la vida y mantiene la dignidad.
Fascisternas flygplan fällde bomber över Madrid och de fick hjälp av både Hitler och Mussolini.
Madrid estaba sitiado. Madrid fuimos un campo de experimentación de todas las armas que entonces habían modernísimas y que las tenía Alemania.
Bombardeaban, estábamos en una...
De bombade oss när vi köade för att köpa bröd.
Venían los bombardeos y...
De bombade oss och vi visste aldrig när flygplanen skulle komma och döda oss.
He was more than anxious to show the effects of the war on the common people. And the pictures he was able to shoot showed the population in a state of terror.
Pictures he caught of the people under bombardment are extraordinary. Of course, what's not seen there, but you have to know that he was standing there while they were running. There were no smart bombs in those days. And the bombs just came out of there in strings and fell wherever they fell.
Always the same. The sirens, the panic rush, the fracas of the bombs. Then as the dust settles, people go off to the morgue to see if, by chance, the sun, the father, the mother that did not come home is on the lists.
Vad hade den här kvinnan gjort? Hon var säkert varken en republikan eller en av Francos anhängare. Hon var en människa som levde sitt liv. Och som frågade sig, varför händer det här? Vad har jag gjort för att det här skulle hända? Robert Capas bilder publicerades i tidningar runt om i världen. Från hela världen strömmade frivilliga till Spanien för att slåss för demokratin. Gerda Taro, som brann för republiken, reste till Spanien som journalist ihop med Capa. Han lärde henne att fotografera och de arbetade sida vid sida. De var beredda att offra sina liv i sin egen kamp mot fascismen. De utsatte sig ofta för livsfara när de fotograferade striderna på nära håll. I lugnet efter en blodig strid, sa Gerda. När man tänker på alla fina människor som blev dödade känns det nästan orättvist att fortfarande vara vid liv. I juli 1937 bröt strider ut i staden Brunete strax väster om Madrid. Gerda tog sin kamera och skyndade dit.
It was the most violent. Lasted for 21 days and casualties were very heavy. What can I tell you? Two battalions went in and one battalion came out.
En general beordrade Gerda att ge sig av, men hon vägrade. Inget kunde hålla henne tillbaka när hon rusade fram över slagfältet samtidigt som hon tog sina bilder.
My whole squad died practically. And one of them died right over there.
De regeringstrogna började retirera. Stridsvagnar och lastbilar krängde fram över slagfältet bland bombkrevader och artillerield. I kaoset och paniken tappade en stridsvagnsförare kontrollen. Gerda satt på fotsteget på en bil när en tank körde rakt in i henne. Hon dog nästa dag.
Capa learned of her death by reading the newspaper. Sitting in a dentist chair, he turned the page, and there was the headline, Gerda Taro killed at Brunete.
En jättelik begravningsprocession följde Gerda till graven på en kyrkogård i Paris. Hon skulle ha fyllt 26 år samma dag. Louis Aragon, redaktör på Cessoir, följde Robert Capa till begravningen.
I saw him crying. It was very strange. And Aragon was holding him. And we came from the cemetery. The death of Gerda was terrible.
All his hope and all his future disappeared in once. It changed him. I'm sure he changed completely in this time.
Dear mother, I'm so nervous and crazy. All I can do is pull myself together and work hard. With time, I shall be more tolerable.
Capas bilder fångade det spanska inbördeskrigets fasor. Tidningen Picture Post skrev att han var världens bästa krigsfotograf. Han var 25 år gammal. I juni 1940 föll Paris i nazisternas händer. Capa var på ett uppdrag i Mexiko när han fick höra de hemska nyheterna.
Dear little brother, European news is miserable and it depresses me very much. The world was never as sad as it is now.
Tre månader senare började tyska flygplan att fälla bomber över London. Capa reste dit för att dokumentera blitzen för tidskriften Life Magazine. Från England reste han till New York. Hans mamma Julia och hans bror Cornell hade flyttat dit några år tidigare och de levde på Upper West Side. Julia var lycklig över att ha båda sönerna i sin närhet.
She had been in fact uprooted and she clung to Kappa. And he wasn't here that much, you know.
Bob, of course, was Julia's favorite son. From the moment that Bob was born, because he had this little six extra finger, she thought that he was going to be a very special person. He knew how to keep her happy with a minimum of time. For example, when she went to Paris, he would send her roses to her hotel room and he would introduce her to all his friends and take her around, but then he would vanish again.
Kappa for västerut för att fotografera jakt.
I have become a complete cowboy. They are big, tough and healthy and have so much fun at whatever they are doing. They don't really give a damn what's happening in Europe.
På uppdrag av Life Magazine reste han runt i hela USA och dokumenterade. Var han än reste lyckades han få bra kontakt med människor. Trots sitt speciella sätt att tala.
His accent was Hungarian and his English, although very clear, had this very definite European accent.
He spoke, of course, in this language that he called Kappanese, which was a horrible English. I think he was impossible to imitate. Kappanese was a language that only was spoken by one person in the world, and that was Kappa.
Kappa började tröttna på att göra lättviktiga reportage för Life. Egentligen ville han resa tillbaka till Europa, men han fick inget visum. När USA gick med i kriget hörde plötsligt Kappa, som var ungersk medborgare, till fiendelägret. Han beordrades att lämna in sina kameror och han fick inte lämna New York. Han skickade ett brev till utrikesdepartementet där han försvarade sig.
I wrote to immigration that I was born in Budapest. That the Hungarian consulate since Hitler's annexation of Hungary refuses to say that I'm not Hungarian. Nor will they say that I am. That so long as Hitler is in charge of Hungary, I definitely refuse to say that I'm Hungarian.
Som avslutning skrev han att han hatade nazisterna och att han hoppades att hans bilder kunde användas mot dem. I april 1942 fick han äntligen sitt visum och han gav sig av till London.
I told her the facts about my dancing. She said my rumba wasn't really bad and could be improved in no time. I answered that in 10 years no one had succeeded in making any improvements. She said she had a brand new idea. I was afraid I had one too.
Kappa kallade henne Pinky för hon hade ljust rödblont hår. De träffades i England medan Kappa väntade på att få ansluta sig till den amerikanska armén. Hon var gift med en pilot, vilket gjorde henne precis lagom oåtkomlig för Kappa. För att förbereda sig för livet vid fronten lät han sy upp en uniform hos en skräddare på Bond Street. Han sa adjö till Pinky och gav sig av till Nordafrika.
I told her that I was a gypsy and a newspaper man. That I was very sorry and very glad. Because she was far too lovely.
I Tunisien anslöt han sig till de amerikanska trupperna när de ryckte fram mot tyskarna.
Dear mother, I would love to be able to bring your birthday present myself, but Rommel is keeping us still busy here.
Från Nordafrika reste Kappa till Sicilien för att dokumentera de allierades invasion. I 7 månader levde han med de amerikanska soldaterna medan de utkämpade hårda strider i Italien.
I dragged myself from mountain to mountain, from foxhole to foxhole, taking pictures of mud, misery and death. Every 5 yards a foxhole, in each at least one dead soldier.
Kappa var med general Patton på Sicilien när Palermo kapitulerade. I det krigshärjade Neapel dokumenterade han en tragisk historia. Unga italienska pojkar hade vänt sig mot tyskarna och skjutit mot dem med vapen som de lyckats komma över. Många av dessa pojkar blev dödade.
Inside the room were 20 primitive coffins, not well enough covered with flowers and too small to hide the dirty little feet of children. These children of Naples had stolen rifles and bullets and had fought the Germans for 14 days. These were my truest pictures of victory.
Efter nästan ett år vid fronten längtade Kappa tillbaka till London och till Pinky. Han visste att invasionen av Frankrike snart skulle börja. Och han blev glad när han förstod att Pinky hade väntat på honom. De flyttade in på det flotta Dorchester Hotel och började leva ett frikostigt liv med Kappas royalty-checkar. Journalister från alla de allierade länderna började samlas i London i väntan på invasionen av Frankrike. Författaren Ernest Hemingway kom dit. Han och Kappa hade blivit vänner under kriget i Spanien.
His nickname was Papa, and I soon adopted him as a father. To prove my devotion and prosperity, I decided to give him a party. The attraction of free booze combined with Mr. Hemingway proved irresistible.
It was a time of eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we may die. Kappa was certainly one of the liveliest of the partiers and the most reckless of the gamblers.
People say that gamblers like to lose. The big thrill is to lose everything and then to be reborn.
Hundratals fartyg gav sig av i skydd av nattens mörker för att påbörja krigets mest avgörande och grymma slag, invasionen av Normandie.
At 4 a.m. we were assembled on the open deck. 2,000 men stood in perfect silence. Whatever they were thinking, it was some kind of prayer.
Robert Kappa valde det farligaste uppdraget, att landsättas med de första trupperna på Omaha Beach. Han var den enda fotografen i den första invasionsvågen.
We got out of the boat and started wading. And then I saw men falling and had to push past their bodies. The bullets tore holes in the water around me and I made for the nearest steel obstacle. My picture frames were filled with shrapnel smoke, burnt tanks and sinking barges. Every piece of shrapnel found a man's body. I did not dare to take my eyes off the finder and frantically shot frame after frame.
Everything came apart. All that we trained for just seemed to go by the boards. And I was so exhausted physically and mentally that I just collapsed in that spot. It was a struggle not against the Germans or anything. It was a struggle to survive, to save your life. And fortunately, I was able to do that.
Den här bilden av Ed Regan är en av de få som finns kvar av Kappas bilder från dagen D. En nervös mörkrumsassistent i London förstörde de flesta negativen. Bara 11 bilder finns kvar. Tidskriften Life Magazine publicerade alla.
And I'm only sad that the other 134 shots that were destroyed in the laboratory couldn't have been witnessed by the entire world, because he probably got the greatest photo record of that invasion and of that morning.
Den morgonen lyckades Kappa kravla sig ombord på en pråm fullastad av sårade och döende som skulle transporteras tillbaka till England. Man erbjöd honom att flyga tillbaka, men han vägrade. Han återvände till stranden med den första båt som hade plats. Runt 10 000 allierade soldater dog på Normandies stränder. Kappa följde med de amerikanska trupperna när de kämpade sig fram genom Frankrike.
When you're taking risks and your life is in danger,
Your adrenaline is pumping so high, you are feeling more alive the closer you are to death than in normal circumstance.
The shells started raining down on us, and I jumped into a big ditch, scared to death. And this man jumps in. He's very calm through this whole thing. And he picks up a conversation as though, and he starts talking about Tolstoy. I'll never forget that. It's like this was just some noise going around. You know, and you'd hear a yell every once in a while, a scream. But he paid no attention to that. He just kept talking to me. And he calmed me down. And the shelling died away, you know, and he kind of smiled at me and said goodbye and hopped out again and disappeared. And I crawled out, you know, and I said something, who's that? And they said, this is a photographer named Kappa. And that was the only time I ever saw him.
Kappa found himself really loved by the American soldiers and officers. He was a good man to have around. Many units even came to regard him as a good luck. That if they had Bob Kappa with them, things were going to go well.
Han utsatte sig för samma faror som soldaterna han fotograferade, från invasionen av Normandie till Ardenneroffensiven. I norra Frankrike förberedde han sig för sin mest skakande upplevelse.
That picture was taken when I was 19 years old. I heard this voice saying, soldier, would you mind standing up? I'd like to take your picture. I think the reason he wanted to take my picture was the fact that I had the Cheyenne Warlock. We had a Cheyenne Indian in my demolition section. And as a result, we used to go into combat with a Cheyenne Warlock. You have something, you know, hey, we're different, we're rough, we're tough, we're better.
Kappa hade frivilligt anslutit sig till en fallskärmstrupp. Den skulle släppas ner bakom fiendens linjer.
It was very fearless in a sense, almost reckless. The idea was to get the photograph, and he would go to almost any lengths to get close action good photographs. Part of you isn't thinking or feeling, and part of you is. You know you're going. Hell, the plane's in the air. You know you're going. And you're not exactly sure what's going to be there when you get there. You know what is supposed to be there.
I started to think over my whole life. It was like a movie where the projection machine has gone crazy. I saw everything I ever ate, ever did, and I got to the end in 12 minutes flat. 600 feet below us was the Rhine. The green light flashed, and the boys yelled, Umbriago!
Sjutton man hoppade ner över Rendalen den dagen. Över en tredjedel dog.
The most amazing thing I ever saw is the way everybody just lies on the ground when they get down. It seemed like 2 minutes and everybody was just lying there.
They were shooting at you as you were coming down. So sometimes some of the troops didn't quite make it to the ground alive.
10 yards away were tall trees. Some of the men who had jumped after me had landed in them, and now they were hanging helplessly.
It's the last good photograph of my right foot, because I left my right foot in Europe. War is gruesome, and somebody has to show it. I often wonder if I could have done it, to be perfectly honest with you. It was one thing to be going someplace where they're throwing things at you when you can shoot back. If you don't have anything but a camera, You don't stop bullets with cameras.
Robert Capa gick in i Leipzig med USAs armé. Tyska krypskyttare gav inte upp ens när staden hade kapitulerat. Han klättrade upp på en balkong där amerikanska soldater besvarade krypskyttarnas eld.
The boy had a clean, open, very young face and his gun was still killing fascists. I clicked my shutter. That was the last one of the boy alive.
Paris befrielse den 24 augusti 1944 var krigets viktigaste ögonblick för Robert Capa.
The road to Paris was open and every Parisian was out in the street to touch the first tank, to kiss the first man. Never were there so many who were so happy so early in the morning. I felt that this entry into Paris had been made especially for me. On a tank made by Americans, I was returning to Paris, the beautiful city where I first learned to eat, drink, and love. Thousands of faces in the finder of my camera became more and more blurred. That finder was very, very wet. We drove through the quarter where I had lived for 6 years, and my concierge was waving a handkerchief, and I was yelling to her from the rolling tank, "C'est moi! C'est moi!"
Capa hade kämpat mot fascismen under nästan ett decennium. I Spanien, i Kina, i Nordafrika och i hela Europa. Han var 32 år gammal och kriget var äntligen över. Capa satt i baren på Ritz i Paris med författaren Irwin Shaw när de fick syn på en anslående uppenbarelse. Ingrid Bergman gick upp för trapporna. De skickade omgående ett meddelande till hennes rum.
We were planning on sending you flowers inviting you to dinner this evening.
But after consultation we discovered it was possible to pay for the flower or the dinner, but not both. So mother went to dinner and she found Bob Capa tremendously charming and amusing, and in fact she fell in love with him.
Ingrid Bergman var på en blixtturné genom Europa för att underhålla de amerikanska trupperna. När arbetet förde Capa till Berlin återfann de varandra.
It's your merry mind that I love, and there are very few merry minds in a man's life.
Ingrid Bergman hade precis vunnit en Oscar för sin rolltolkning i Gasljus. Hon skulle snart återvända till Hollywood för att påbörja sin nästa film. Hon spelade huvudrollen i Alfred Hitchcocks romantiska thriller Notorious. När filmarbetet pågått ett tag anlände Capa. Han hade fått jobb som stillbildsfotograf i produktionsteamet.
Capa reached a certain point in his career when he no longer wanted to be a war photographer. And he thought he might like to go in the movie business. The movie business, unlike war, is quite boring. Well, quite like war in that you're bored a lot of the time and you get a little action sporadically. And Capa found it very boring.
Robert Capa kom till inspelningen varje dag, men de valde att vara försiktiga och inte visa sina känslor offentligt. Många år senare skulle hon avslöja kärleksaffären i sina memoarer.
This part of being in love with Capa while she was married was not easy at all, she says, because I was so moral, so prudish, you might say, but I wanted very much to be with him.
Medan Kappa inväntade stunderna med Ingrid på tu man hand utforskade han sällskapslivet i Hollywood.
He was of course socially very acceptable. First of all, he was nice looking. He was had a good sense of humor. He was famous in a certain circle. And he was a single man.
Men han trivdes inte i det glamorösa Hollywood.
He said to me, I hate to go to people's houses. And that's why I don't like L.A., because in L.A. everything takes place in people's houses. I want to be in a cafe, so when I get finished, I get up and I go to the next place.
Uttråkad av arbetet och rastlös i Hollywood sökte Kappa efter andra sätt att roa sig. För en kort tid var han egyptien Hamza i en B-film med titeln Temptation.
Where's Abdallah?
Abdallah sick. Me cousin, doing work. Me Hamza.
All right, bring us the coffee, Abdallah.
Me Hamza.
Never mind, make it quick.
Han kom fram till att filmbranschen inte passade honom.
Hollywood is the biggest mess of shit I ever stepped in.
Han sa adjö till Ingrid och gav sig av på ett uppdrag i Turkiet.
Mother was ready to ask for a divorce and marry Kappa. But Kappa said, I cannot marry you. If they say Korea tomorrow and we're married and have a child, I won't be able to go to Korea. And that's impossible. I'm not the marrying kind.
So that's it. You won't stay here and I can't go with you.
It would be the wrong thing.
Apparently, Alfred Hitchcock wrote Rear Window inspired to this love affair between my mother and Bob Kappa.
Can you see me driving down to the fashion salon in a Jeep wearing combat boots and a three-day beard? Will that make a hit?
Well, I could see you looking very handsome and successful in a dark blue flannel suit.
Now, let's stop talking nonsense, shall we?
Guess I'd better start setting up for dinner.
He wasn't made to be married. I mean, he was a single person. He loved to be surrounded by friends, girls. But to attach himself down someplace with somebody, I think he was really afraid of it.
I'm a newspaper man again, and it is all right. I sleep in strange hotels, read during the night. It's good to work, to think, to be lonely.
På våren 1947 i New York förverkligade Robert Kappa en livslång dröm. Han kallade den Magnum.
We chose that name on account of when we were meeting. It was a bottle of champagne. Though I don't drink that stuff. I'm for red wine.
Kappas idé var att skapa en bildbyrå i form av ett kooperativ tillsammans med andra oberoende fotografer. Först övertalade han sin gamle vän David Seymour, kallad Chim, att gå med. Chim övertalade i sin tur Henri Cartier-Bresson och så var de tre musketörerna tillsammans igen. George Roger, en engelsk fotograf som Kappa lärt känna under kriget, blev den fjärde medlemmen.
Oh my god, that was something. Because they were so far apart, you know, from background, education, everything. I mean, it was amazing the way they could actually work together.
The big, big thing which Kappa brought by creating Magnum is to be independent.
I think he invented the idea of photographers owning their own negatives so that they can sell the pictures to more than one magazine at a time.
That was what we were fighting for, to control our works. And it's a way to be respected and not to be employees and tools of big magazines. That was the main thing of Magnum.
Robert Kappa fick in många unga begåvade fotografer i Magnum.
Some people said Magnum is a family. In a way, yes. Obviously, father of the family was Kappa. And we would all go to him to complain if no job, if no money. And he would listen, and he would really put forward some ideas for big projects.
Magnums rykte spred sig när de lyckades knyta de bästa fotojournalisterna till bildbyrån. Robert Capa själv var berömd, inte bara som en legendarisk krigsfotograf utan även som en firad man i stans sällskapsliv. Sommaren 1948 reste Capa till Sydfrankrike för att fotografera François Gillot och Pablo Picasso.
It was not for a day, it came for about 2 weeks. That's also was probably his method. You see, he would live with you, spend the day with you doing what you were doing. He did not simmer. Taking a photograph a little bit more like this, a little more like that, or waiting for the exact light, etc. No, he felt like it, bang.
Robert Capa hade blivit en man han själv hittat på. En framgångsrik amerikansk fotograf, alltid på väg mot nya uppdrag och som frotterade sig med de rika och berömda runt om i världen.
He was terribly anxious about having enough money to keep things rolling. And he was actually tired of carrying all the burdens of Magnum on his shoulders.
För att fly undan sina privata bekymmer for Capa runt i hela Europa där han fotograferade berömda filmstjärnor och gjorde reportage om livet på olika semesterorter för resemagasin.
I think he was playing in life and happy, fun, drinker, party, lover.
It was a great opportunity for him, and after 2 weeks he was unfortunately offered an assignment by Life magazine to cover the French war in Indochina. I called Tokyo. I said, Bob, you know, you don't have to go. This isn't our war.
Colonel Capa blev bestört när han fick veta att hans bror ville ge sig ut i ännu ett krig.
I much appreciate your calling, but be assured that I didn't take the job from a sense of duty, but with real great pleasure.
I think that the struggle was for him to get again to Capa. He wanted to work again, and that he hoped to do in Vietnam.
What amazed me about Capa was that he was a legendary figure and he'd covered 4 wars before he came to Vietnam. I expected somebody, well, really a lot older in age, and actually he was very young, I thought. I thought he was very young. I was 29, he was 40. He was very glad the Vietnamese people were winning the war. Very glad, as was I. It was no question about that. It was an ardent feeling we had.
Capa fotograferade vietnameser som levde i krigets skugga. Han planerade att kalla sitt reportage Bitter Rice. Kriget höll på att ta slut och fransmännen retirerade. Capa anslöt sig till en fransk konvoj. De skulle göra en sista framstöt i Röda flodens delta. Vägarna och fälten var minerade. Capa åkte med några soldater och journalister. De varnade honom för att lämna konvojen.
He had a very famous saying, which was something like, if your picture is not good enough, you were not close enough.
I don't think he was careless. He said this many times. I will be totally careful, except when there's only one place from which I can take a picture, and the picture I want, he said, then I'm going to go there.
När lastbilen stannade sa Capa till sina kollegor att han ville gå lite längs vägen och att de skulle se till honom när det var dags att köra igen.
I mean, just looking at the pictures, you could see he was sticking with the soldiers. He was a pro.
Det här är den sista bilden som Robert Capa tog. Han hade råkat trampa på en landmina.
They rushed to where Capa's body was, but there was no way to save him. He was gone by the time the ambulance came.
Robert Capa blev 40 år och fick en militärbegravning i Hanoi 1954. Han var den första amerikanske krigskorrespondenten som dog i Vietnam.
we marched behind the casket. It was really very moving.
Kroppen skickades hem. Armén erbjöd honom en plats på militärkyrkogården Arlington. Julia sa att hennes son aldrig varit soldat, utan en fredens man. Han begravdes på en kyrkogård i Purchase strax utanför New York.
Cornell stood and put a prayer shawl over and recited Kaddish.
And Julia wanted to jump into the grave. And Julia was beyond herself for years. She never got over his death.
Robert was her pride and joy, the light of her life. But she was also extremely angry. She was angry at the whole business that put him in harm's way at a time that he really should have retired from harm's way.
Robert Capa hade dokumenterat oräkneliga slag och 5 krig som utkämpats i 10 olika länder. Han efterlämnade 70 000 negativ, en enastående dokumentation av krigets mörker och ljuset i människans själ.
It's a way of loving to take pictures and hating at the same time, fighting must keep on.
Nästa vecka handlar K-special om en av våra mest älskade diktare, Harry Martinsson, som i år skulle ha fyllt